everyone, welcome to the Dead Horse Podcast. I'm Vivek, I'm your host for this week. With me are Arvind.
Hello.
Tejas.
Hello.
And Rashi is joining us back after a bit of a break because we were recording on Sundays. Hi, Rashi.
Yo. Hey, what's up?
Alright, so let's kick it off with the latest game that's come out. Arvind and Tejas have both been playing Civilization Beyond Earth.
Yeah.
How is it?
Maybe Tejas wants to go first, or should I?
Oh, hell, I'll go first. I love that game. It is brilliant. Though I will have to agree, sadly, with a lot of reviews that have been coming out, that it does feel more like a fantastic expansion, more than a standalone. I think... It does so many things right. Like, they've got so many great mechanics that really make the world feel more interactive than it would when you're playing Civilization normally. Like, generally, when you play any of the other Civs, it's almost board game-like, you know? You're playing the mechanics, you're playing the rules, you know what they are, and you're optimizing what, you know, every move that you have, and that's generally how you play it. But with Civ, just, you know, like with the quest lines and the fact that you have the intrigue stuff going and just the slightly different victory conditions, and that just adds enough to the gameplay to make it feel like, you know, there's more going on. And it adds just that little touch of, you know, narrative that I think the game was lacking. So, yeah, I'm loving it. I think it does lie somewhere in that weird spot between expansion and sequel. It's neither.
Yeah. Though I am, like, a bit disappointed in how they handled, like, certain mechanics. Like, energy. Like, okay, energy is like gold from Civilization. It's exactly like gold. But then why can I just buy buildings from energy? Like, how does that work? So I don't get that. And, like, I feel that this game is a missed opportunity because they could have completely, like, rethought what made Civilization tick, you know? Instead of being like, okay, there's science, okay, there's culture, okay, there's, like, there's gold / energy, then there's happiness. Like, they should have been like, okay, tell you what, like, it's a bunch of people, like, dropping on a new planet, they're colonists. So some colonists are like, we won't have any currency, for example. We don't need any currency. We'll just, like, whoever works hard does all that. And, like, I also don't like the way, like in theory, purity, supremacy, harmony are great concepts. But they don't feel different. Like, they just feel like a difference, like your units change color based on what you're doing. Because, like, to me, it was like a harmony player's, like, empire, you know, like the tiles, the improvements they have on the tiles should look and function completely different from a purity player. Purity and harmony are, like, directly opposite. So, but, like, you still make the same improvements. You can even make the same units if you want, if you research, like, some, like, nodes. So I don't get that. Like, and I also don't like the way this game handles, like, certain resources, because, I in my first game, I made a harmony civilization. I was like, yes, big aliens, I'm going to make harmony.
I went the same route. I was like, okay, I'm going to go full harmony, you know, I hate to make this reference, but I was going to go full avatar on that. but, you know, I agree, like, but... you know, on the flip side, I can see that becoming incredibly convoluted if, you know, functions for different, according to your affinity points change. Because, like, think about it, because then not only do they have to give you different functions if you are purity, harmony, or...
But, like, for this stuff, like...
There's also
mixtures, really,
right? Like, you know, what if you were four points each...
Yeah. No, I mean, I hate to bring that up, but, like, the they made a game already that did this better, like, you know, like Alpha Centauri. So, like, what I wanted from this was, like, for, like, the three ways should feel different. And, like to me the starting civilizations, you know, like whatever they are, like some like Pan-Asian cooperative and like Australia or something, I don't know, whatever. They are functionally completely identical. Only different in like the few starting game bonuses. So like what I would have wanted was to like if you are looking for like different like I said like you know different improvements such then make it like okay like for example like just like of a like thought experiment kind of thing like you have like three harmony like civilizations. One of them is like we want to become completely like the planet. So they start human, but then they slowly like, you know, Zerg like, they become Zerg like creatures and such. That's the second one are like, okay, no, we will stay human, but we will coexist peacefully. So they end up looking more like your elves, you know, tree huggers, that sort of thing. And the third one can be like what the harmony thing is like in the middle kind of, where their units are like hybrids. So like,
And there should be a fourth one, which is basically you playing through Interstellar, the movie.
There are, like, the Interstellar and this do share a lot of art. Like, in fact, like, my brother, when he looked at the disc, he was like, is this the movie tie-in game for Interstellar? That's what he said.
Wow.
I can't wait to watch Interstellar, by the way.
Hey, it's coming to IMAX in Hyderabad, so I'm stoked
about
that.
Oh, you have an IMAX screen!
Yeah. It is gonna be epic.
Yeah, I'm looking forward to it too. Yeah. So yeah, ultimately like and one like okay, forget it. Maybe it couldn't have been like different like Alpha Centauri and like but another problem I have with this is that like right now it's a lot more boring. Like there are like a lot of turns where I have nothing to do because workers take like 8, 10, 12 turns to build anything. And
yeah, improvements like, take a while.
Yeah. And like if and because of the aliens on the map, like starting in the start war is impossible. You don't have those like early game aggressive civilizations, you know, like you have like Babylon and such in Civ. You don't have those. So you can only wage war late game. And that would be fine, except like aliens, it's like they're not as like as menacing as it was in the trailer. At least in my like experience in the game, like for the most part, like their guys just die in one hit, and if you pick like the one purity stat, like my second game was a purity civ, then they just ignore your vulnerable units. So then, like, they're not much of a threat. Because they'll only attack those units which can easily kill them. So yeah, like it needs a lot of balance. Like, trade routes are super OP. Like
oh, yeah. The trade routes are... I enjoy the trade routes. They're fucking awesome.
Yeah. But at the same time, you have, like with two or three trade routes, those trade alone makes more than like your cities combined in energy. Like that's insane for me at least. So yeah, like I don't know why. And like trade is one thing which I don't like quite understand why it's there, like in that form. Because I mean your guys are colonists and like based on the whole plot lore kind of thing, they weren't expecting the others. So them having like convoys to immediately like, you know, start trading. It's kind of weird to me. Like, it doesn't seem to, like, it doesn't jive well with, like, I think the setting also needed a bit more work. Like, Civ has the benefit of, like, human history doing all of the lore work for it. But here with Beyond Earth, they had the chance to make their own narrative. And, like, I think they, like, kind of flubbed it. They didn't really, like, yeah, they could have, like, done a better job. Like, they could have, like, looked at the game they already made. And, like, it needs some personality, like, is what I think.
I don't know, like, speaking from experience, isn't that always the thing that comes to Civ games in expansions, though? Like, if we're looking at this as another civilization, like, looking at this as an offshoot of the Civilization main series, I expect that personality will arrive in the form of phenomenal expansions which we'll see coming out over the next few years. Right?
Uh, Well, I don't know. Like, I don't know if that's, like, true. Because, like, the personality in Civilization 5, like, when we talk about personality, we talk about, for example, you know, like, Gandhi nuclear bomb thing. And, like, and then, like, suddenly your, like, puny empire of Hivatha, like, standing up against Genghis Khan, that sort of thing. So that wasn't really brought in by the expansions. The expansions brought the gameplay balance and all of that stuff.
Well, they made the gameplay genuinely interesting. Like, I mean, Civ 5 at a base level was not as interesting as it became when Gods and Kings came out, right?
Yeah.
Gods and Kings really changed that game in a major way. So I expect, like this already has a neat idea and some interesting mechanics. I think we'll see those mature as the expansions come out. I think a lot of people had similar complaints about XCOM 2, not to the same degree, because XCOM is such a radical departure from what Firaxis usually made.
But I don't know. Like, I loved XCOM. Like this is my reaction to this is way more muted. Like, I think more muted than even like Civ 5, because like for me at least, like they especially like to me they dropped the ball in the factions. The factions are absolutely identical. So,
hey, whatever you say, the Kavitaan Protectorate, that is, as a concept, is very interesting.
Yeah,
okay?
That one faction is the, like, is the only, like, kind of interesting, because that's like a religious sort of faction.
Exactly, but and it's
like, it doesn't translate to in-game.
It sounds like a bunch of Brahmins got together and went to space.
Oh my god, I gotta play this game!
No, not just like, you know, like you have those like Baba Ramdev ka ashram types. If one of that ashram just
that is exactly
off,
what
space.
It sounds like.
It
oh my god, guys, realize what you're saying? You're saying basically all our parents somehow went into space.
Yes. without us. They went to space without us, Vivek, dude. Like, we got left behind because we weren't good
like,
enough.
Basically, our dads and moms were like, our children don't get it. We're going to space.
Your parents,
they have
you
no
guys
values.
Religious parents, if that's the case. Like.
There's no sanskar.
Yeah, there's no sanskar. So, like, they go to space and set up sanskar in space.
Yeah.
The funny thing is that, the dialogue, like, she talks in Hindi, right? And she says stuff that was cliche in 1995. Like, when she comes to you with the friendship agreement, she's like, ek aur ek gyara hote hain. And I'm like, yeah. Well, I was like, yaar, this is 2645. You don't have to say stuff from 1995.
That's the same hilarious accent that the Dreamfall Chapters lady says it in. Like, does she say stuff like Bancho?
I have not heard that Dreamfall chapter's.
Oh my god! You need to listen to that Dreamfall. Yeah. Like, it's the new. Like they've started telling the Dreamfall story again. The first episode is out of Dreamfall chapters. There's an Indian lady in it, and her name's Meera, and she swears like anything, and she swears like she gives Hindi galis. But it's a person who's clearly never spoken in Hindi before.
I don't know if Gandu.
And on top of that, that's really a fun new gali for me to give people.
The way the galis are delivered is like English gali ko replace kar diya. Like instead of changing the sentence structure, like how people normally do that, like because it's clearly like the guy isn't Indian, like who wrote the dialogue. So he just like for example, like he replaced fucker with like what Gandu, like stuff like that. So
really, that's what he replaced fucker with.
No,
what
actually, I think it is an Indian person who hasn't lived in India for a really really long time. Because there's no way you have that kind of knowledge of Indian galis.
Dreamfall didn't like. I think Ragnar Tronkist wrote all of it, right? So like he's not Indian, like so.
Well, there's also John Walker.
Yeah, so he's not Indian either, like, unless I'm, like, missing something, so.
Yeah, that's there, but now I have John Walker in my head, like, looking up Indian swear words, and
he didn't actually end up working on the game, like, by the way, so, like.
Oh, really?
So yeah, that and just aside, like, maybe 2014 is the year of the, like, badly written Indian characters in gaming or something. Like, I don't know. But yeah, like, coming back to Beyond Earth, like, I feel like this is a very rough cut of what could be a great idea. Maybe two expansions down the line. And maybe that's what, like, these, like, Firaxis want. So, hey. But, like, it's...
I have no problem with that if, like, eventually they end up building a really, really strong brand that is different, completely different from Civilization and like, well, I understand that gameplay-wise it can't be completely different, but it has its own identity that is separate from that of Civilization.
Yeah, like, that's what's missing. Like, it doesn't have its own identity at the moment. It's too heavily rooted in, like, Civ 5's.
Yeah, it's too familiar immediately, and which is fine. Like, you want that familiarity when you begin a game, especially when you want to begin divorcing it from the core. But it doesn't really, you know, deviate that much, which is why everyone keeps thinking it feels more like an expansion than a sequel. But
yeah,
you know, I agree with your points about, you know, the fact that the game should have. You know, the expansion should help it, you know, find its identity. But I, at the same time, I kind of wish that, you know, it at least had more of it, more of that identity upon release rather than having to wait for
expansions.
But, you know, again, I'm probably not going to be as critical of it as you are, Arvind, just for the sake that I'm a huge fan of the studio, so...
I love Firaxis too, but yeah, like, this game, like, I think, like, my disappointment stems for, like, the fact that, like, I was super looking forward to it because, you know, like Alpha Centauri and all that.
I think what Arvind's saying is that it's not a bad game, but considering the expectations you have from Firaxis and the fact that they deliver every time, it's a little bit disappointing.
Yeah, trust me, like 99% of games would kill to be, like, as good. Like,
as Beyond Earth, yeah.
Like, but at the same time, like, since it's Firaxis and since, like, I still play, like, Alpha Centauri, like, off and on, like, once per, like, 2-3 months. So this is in nostalgia because I got it off GOG, like, last year or so. So, but, like, that game was oozing with personality. And, like, it had the feel of, like, you exploring something new. Like, completely different societal structure, completely different ways of thinking. And it was more alien, like, you know? Like,
it was more exploration-based, too. Like, you had to figure things out. You were trying to understand the world and, you know, work with it. Here, it's like, you know, it's the same as Civilization, you know? Just, this is... Earth, how do I exploit it? Which is what civilizations do in general. But when you're somewhere so alien, so quickly, it should have been, more like, with just more places where you're trying to figure out, you know, what happens if, you know, people move into miasma, you know? Like, it shouldn't just be so simple as, oh yeah, I walked in, I take damage, I walk out, I heal, you know, or I have to, sit, you know, fortify to heal.
For example, like in Alpha Centauri, like at towards the end game, like every civilization, you could just tell what the civilization was by looking at their like terrain and stuff, because like the nature, like tree hugger civilization, like Lady Driadre, like that was all fungus, covered with fungus, had mind worms, that sort of thing, and some of the others had like completely like drilled and bored the earth, and there was the religious war lady, like, I don't know, like, I don't remember her, but, like, she was, like, you know, future, like, Templars, Warhammers sort of thing. So, that showed that you could have done, like, all this different looking kind of stuff, because, hopefully, like, Firaxis take all this feedback into account, and, like, the first expansion is basically just that.
I'm sure they will, because, like, I mean, there are very few studios whom I kind of basically give a free pass to, and Firaxis and CD Projekt are basically on the top of that list because they've never let me down. They've always made amazing games. a CD Projekt's list of amazing games is short because there are just two games on it. But those two games are so good that I will give them a free pass even if Witcher 3 is not as good as people expect it to be, and I'm fully expecting that it will not be as good as people expect it to be, because people expect it to be Grand Theft Auto 5 meets
Skyrim,
which is not possible, you know. Anyway, aside about expectations, extraordinary expectations from video game studios, aside from that, I think it's really interesting to see that these guys have put out something that's kind of polarizing, but it's still, at the end of the day, that baseline level of quality is still there. And I think it's an interesting place to segue from here to a game from which no one had any expectations, but it turned out to be, surprisingly, I think, a lot of people's favorites of this year. We discussed this last week, actually, Shadow of Mordor, which I've played. Arvind has beaten. Rashi, have you finished it yet?
Yeah, I finished it.
All right, so what did you think about it? What did you think about Shadow of Mordor?
It was an interesting game, definitely. The Nemesis system, they had, advertised, it was fun initially. Obviously, if you play too much of it, you might get bored like I did. I mean, I held off on the main missions for as long as I could, and I tried to finish the side missions.
Okay.
So, yeah. So, I mean, the Nemesis system is interesting initially, but I don't know. I mean, I kind of started getting bored with it later on. Yeah.
No, you are definitely right, because for the first 10 hours of Shadow of Mordor, I was like, oh my god, this is the best game ever. I'm going to play it forever.
Yeah.
You know? Because at that time, the Nemesis system was fresh, and I was one of the orcs just had this flaming torch on his head for some reason. And one of the others had a bag on his head. And it was all weird kind of orcs, you know? But then slowly, they started, feeling the same, looking the same.
And then the other thing that I kind of found weird was the whole branding, the whole branding that we do on enemy orcs. Suddenly, it just comes in the middle of the game, You don't get it pretty early on. I think it was an important feature, and they could have given it during the start of the game or a little earlier in the game.
Yeah, Vivek and I were talking about this, and what this game should have been was, instead of the branding thing, you should have played as Radbag. Radbag should have been the protagonist of this game. That would have been the best game ever made.
I agree. I still think there's a DLC called Radbag's Revenge.
Radbag didn't die on
I
screen.
Yeah. I do know that we might be getting a DLC in which we play as the Black Hand or something.
Oh, seriously?
Yeah, and I think it's free, so anybody can play it. I mean, as long as
No, it's just, that is just the skin. It just changes your character model to be the Black Hand. Doesn't change
what?
Anything.
Yeah.
Really?
In the cutscenes.
Yeah.
Yeah, in cutscenes, In cutscenes, you revert back to broody Italian Aragorn knockoff skin. That is.
The more I play this game, the less I like Talion, and the more I like everyone else.
Talion is the definition of generic. When you try to explain somebody what generic means, you can just show the face of Talion, and they'll get it. Because this guy.
It's a good verb to use for generic from now on. Don't be such a Talion.
I mean, first of all, the guy's power set is somebody's writing a fan fiction, with a Mary Sue character, and they want to be Aragorn, but this instance they can't be Aragorn. This guy looks exactly like Aragorn, has the same hairstyle, but. It's different because his clothes are like Ned Stark. That is completely different.
He just made the best character ever, right?
Combined. Yeah. Aragorn, Ned Stark, Aragorn.
Yeah.
So are we just talking about Boromir here?
Oh, yeah. Actually.
shit.
Yeah, no, but like his clothes are not like Boromir from the movies. They're like they are very much like Ned Stark. You know when Ned Stark is doing the like the famous scene, Winter is coming, like the person who sentences swings the sword. He's wearing that kind of cloak. Like, too bad Sean Bean had to die though. Like, and in every other movie.
But he does, right? That's
what he does. I think that's part of his contract now, that I won't sign a movie until I die.
No, I won't sign a movie until I read this death scene.
Yeah, like, unless it's a meaningful death, I'm just not, you know, fuck it, I'm not signing.
Is my character likable? Does he die in within the first hour?
Yeah. But yeah, so yeah, and like, you guys like have any opinion about like the abrupt switch in the middle? Like, I think that's what Rashis was saying too, like, you know?
Just to be clear here, I haven't played yet, so let's be easy on some of the spoilers, yeah?
It's not really a spoiler, it's just like for the first half of the game, you're in one sandbox, and then in the second half of the game, you're in another sandbox. That's completely divorced from the first. Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, true that.
You can travel.
So that felt weird to me. Like, why was that there? Like, just make the first one bigger. Like, what? Like.
Yeah, no, as soon as that happened, I went back to the first one. Like, because I felt more at home there.
The only reason I went back to the first one was because I had to finish this one guy who had been killing me and he just wouldn't die. There was this one war chief. With the poison staff or something. He was a bitch.
Some of them are really hard to kill. Oh!
Yeah.
It's kind of interesting. Like I forgot to mention this last week. I don't know if any of you have noticed this, but apparently people on your Steam friends list who are also playing Shadow of Mordor, they can see when a war chief has killed you and they can avenge you by killing that war chief in their game.
Not
somehow.
Just war chief, like captain.
Yeah,
like I saw my friends on this, like
I
you can avenge
one
them.
Guy.
Yeah, yeah I avenged. Yeah.
I think, no?
Yeah, I avenged exactly one guy, then figured out that the XP was like 1/5 of what you get from the story missions and then never avenged anyone ever again.
So you basically played like Arvin.
Yeah. I mean, yeah, like I was playing, like, usually, like, I play these open world sandbox, you know, 500 things to collect, 500 side missions, in a very, like, janitorial way, as in, like, I'm like, okay, map ko saaf karna hai. So all the markers from one place must be cleared first, then the second place. So, by the time I had, like, finished the story of the first sandbox, I had already cleared all of the map. So, as soon as it was second sandbox, I had no reason to go back. So.
Yeah.
But that was weird because I liked the first one's design more. Like, first one felt like Mordor. Second one felt like, yeah, it's just
really
like, yeah. I mean, it was like good in the sense that like it had like tougher creatures and all that stuff. But, I felt like instead of just making these like one is the, you know, like it's like lava world and like green grass world.
I feel it would be interesting if you had new enemies in this new area that you had to fight completely differently.
It had grogs. Like, the first one, I think, just had one grog. The new ones had, like, four or five.
Yeah, but it's grog. Like, I mean, okay, fine, grogs, great. But aside from that, I think there's no... There are no
nothing
new enemies. That universe has a lot of different characters. If you have to fight... I don't know, like, if for some reason, for some inconceivable reason, Galleon has to fight Elf, that would be cool. As far as Lord of the Rings lore is concerned, this story is already so much bullshit that if for some reason they just, you know, they reach into the Warhammer 40k universe, pluck out Dark Eldar and throw them into this game, nobody would have a problem with that.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean,
yeah.
You didn't look at like the LOTR forums, like fan forums though. Like, I just like went into them like to figure out what, and oh my god, all of them were so upset with this game for like just...
No. Yeah. There are people who are really, really like emotionally upset. Like, I don't know if you know this guy, you know Seamus Young, right, Arvin?
Yeah.
He wrote an article basically lamenting what a piece of shit this game is because of what they did with the story.
Yeah. but like on one hand, like I can, I'm like, yeah, this game, like since I have only watched the movies, so I don't have that much attachment to LOTR. And like LOTR
no,
suffers
like,
from the like Sane Field effect
agree,
for
like,
me. That like I've seen all the, like, you know what the Sane Field effect is, right? You've seen all the stuff that's been inspired from it. So when you watch the original, like you are like, well,
I,
this is
kind of yeah. Sure.
So like for me, I was like, yeah, whatever. Like LOTR doesn't matter. Like elves, orcs, it's LOTR. But like but on the other hand, like they took the LOTR license for precisely the fact that like there are so many people attached to it. So they'll have the initial fan excitement and such. So I mean, on one hand, like you shouldn't have taken the license if you just wanted to have like a like guy come back from the dead, which is impossible
yeah.
in LOTR. So.
But on the other hand, you finally made a good game with the Lord of the Rings license.
Well, I mean, that's a bit harsh on those RTSs that were there, like Middle Earth. You know?
It's not too harsh though. It's not too harsh. Like those RTSs were all right, but they weren't like this is genuinely, this is a game of the year contender as far as I'm concerned. Because it's the first, like I said, this is the first game that deserves to be called next gen because it takes the open world idea and does something genuinely different with it, you know? And I think it shows the path, like, I think, yeah, you're right, like, by the end of the experience, it starts to wear thin, but it's good enough to keep you gripped for at least the first 10 to 15 hours. And
oh, definitely.
Now that they've built this system, they can just start layering complexity on top of it, you know? And I think that like an evolution of the system will come in the sequel that they make, which is, I don't know, Shadows of Mordor or whatever they decide to call it.
Yeah. I mean, like, I don't think the Nemesis system is a good idea. Don't get me wrong. Like, it's a great idea, but there's like, it's not like this thing couldn't have been done in the previous console generation. Because
no,
it's
it
like,
it is the first genuinely, like, it is the first genuinely new thing I've seen in this generation.
Oh,
it has,
true that.
Yeah.
It has nothing to do in terms of, like, whether it could have been done last generation. I'm sure it could have. Or maybe it couldn't have, I don't know. But it's the first genuinely different kind of, like, system that I've seen in, like, in terms of gameplay, in terms of mechanics. And now they can start layering complexity and making it more and more interesting in terms of how you can tweak those relationships. Like, eventually what I'm saying is I basically want Shadows of Crusader Kings 2.
That would be insane. Yeah. Like if they, yeah, seriously, like Assassin's Creed should be taking notes from this. Like,
yeah, they should. They won't, but they should.
Yeah. I mean, instead of making the game about like pirates or whatever, like just make a game that's like, this game is more Assassin's Creed than any except one. Only one had more assassination kind of thing than, like, probably.
Yeah, but even then, I'd say this game has better stealth. Like, I don't know, we talked about this last week. This game has better stealth than any of the Assassin's Creed games.
Yeah, that you are right about that, yeah.
Like, because the enemies feel genuinely powerful and you feel like you need to hide. I've never felt that in any Assassin's Creed game. I've never felt the need to hide. Because Ezio, whoever the hell you're playing, is so goddamn powerful.
Yeah, and you can abuse counter-attack. Like, that's the one strategy. Like, yeah, clearly the people fighting, like, medieval wars, like, all they had to do was just counter every single person who, like,
pretty much.
But I did like how they, you know, even though there were obviously limited choices, I mean, you can't have, like, infinite choices with this, but I liked how, you know, you have to think and make up strategies of how to fight a particular war chief or a captain. I enjoyed that a lot.
It sort of reminded me of, you know, like in Assassin's Creed 1, you had to collect clues. If you collected more clues, you got like info about that guy's weaknesses.
Yeah.
So you can approach like from certain other, like for example, you could drop down from the roof and kill him instant or something. Yeah, that's what it. No, this, and like their systems are very well implemented because. Like, I would love it if I found a war chief that was vulnerable to stealth. Could be insta-killed by stealth. Because then I would just, completely, like, avoid all patrols and all that sort of stuff. And, like, make sure to, like, the first time somebody sees me is when I'm, like, stabbing that guy.
Yeah.
To death.
so that everybody runs away as soon as you kill him.
Yeah.
There have been so many times
when there were like two captains in one area, and this captain hates what were those wolf dogs called?
Karagors,
yeah. So one of them hates Karagors and the other one is like sort of afraid of them. So it's fun to sort of try and balance things out.
Yeah, they just, weirdly enough, they never mention wargs in this entire game.
Yeah, exactly.
So speaking about wargs too, they call them Karagors. I have no idea where that term comes from.
Yeah,
I
was like,
I thought they were wargs, and I'm like, wait, aren't they wargs? What are they? Why are they called Karagors?
Why did you have to invent like Grog? You could have just used a troll, like, you know, like they are an LOTR, like, and like again like skags and like, so yeah, I don't know why they did that. Like, maybe it's because like they only had the license of like, but like the Peter Jackson movies have skags and trolls in them, so.
Yeah, I don't know. I think I realize what the sequel is going to be. Shadows of Mordor. It's going to be Shadows of Moria. That would be really, really interesting. Like a Lord of the Rings open world game set inside the mines of Moria. On one hand, it would make a lot of people think about the Deep Roads from Dragon Age Origins. But on the other hand, it could be really awesome.
You just triggered me. Now you have to like wait. Deep Roads, oh my god. I think the next game should be like a more detailed hierarchy with the nemesis stuff, and you start out at the bottom, like, of the hierarchy.
That hierarchy with more ways to
I mean, if you're gonna have like the system where you can brainwash any person, like have like characters react to that. That's a very like, in Lord of the Rings, that's like the worst thing you can do. Like, so by the end, like, Talion is genuinely, like, in the same scale of, in the same scale of evil as the Ring Wraiths. Like, that's what, he's not a good person by any stretch. Oh, and, like, by the way, like, you guys have played the final two missions, right? Like, which are, like, no doubt the worst two missions of the entire game.
Yeah.
I have not beaten it yet, but, like, I do agree with your analysis that it's starting to get a little bit, just a little bit irritating in terms of the story stuff. I still like the systemic nemesis stuff, but the story stuff is really starting to irritate me now, because, my god, I felt a little bit bad for Talion, because, you know, the revenge plot is stupid, but at least it is what you need to get the momentum going, but now it's just like, what is this bullshit that's happening? Why is this happening?
Yeah, I mean, the revenge plot, like, ultimately is just, like, so half-assedly done. It's like, they introduce, okay, this is your son. 30 seconds later, son dead. This is your wife. 30 seconds later, wife dead. I mean, like, what? Like,
no. There was this scene in the beginning, right? Like, you have to creep up on your wife and then you have to press up.
Yeah, what the
I kept
fuck?
On laughing at that. Why do you have to sneak in to be with your wife or something? I don't understand that.
Yeah, I don't know, yeah. Like, what I was saying, like, this would have been more funny if, like, you, like, it says, like, press to kiss your wife, and you, like, press the button and Talion just violently stabs her, and that's why she's dead.
No revenge!
I bet you any amount of money. At one point of time, that was a bug that they had to fix.
Yeah. I mean, like, that's what ties into, like, Talion's genericness. There is no part of Talion which is interesting. Whatever Talion touches turns uninteresting. Like, that's the level of, like, blandness we're talking here. Like,
I really think they need a better protagonist for the next game.
If they had like a better plot, like at least like a more memorable, this would have been like one of those like all time great games. Instead of just like
Game of... it's close it's close to being, like, it is so far the best game that's come out in this next-gen, whole next-gen thing. It is so far the best game in that, but if it had a good narrative, like, if it had a good plot, forget narrative, I think it has an excellent narrative because of the Nemesis system. So player-driven stuff is great. But if it had a good plot from, like, the ground up, that would have been amazing. Like, you know what? They don't have to change that much. If this whole story was about, like, if they had just changed it and basically overtly shown, like what you said, that he is a bad guy by the end of all of this, that would have been enough for it to be a good plot.
Yeah.
You know, if they, instead of him basically being like, I'm the best, and the story going, yes, Stalin, you're the best.
Yeah.
That fucking stupid bro shit does with that.
Why did they have to put a brick in front, you know, instead of his face? I don't understand.
Yeah.
He was too stone-faced as well.
Yeah. Make Radbag, like, what they should have done was, like, at the start, you know, the like, the ritual sacrifice kind of thing, they're just sacrificing a bunch of no-name orcs, and one of them, like, happens to be Radbag or whatever. And, like, they kill Radbag, and, like, the elf, like, goes into Radbag. And you don't have to change anything else. Like,
Radbag being like a buddy crime-solving duo, like that is a game I would play till the end of time. That would have been hilarious.
Yeah.
There is comedy there already between the elf and Radbag. Like,
yeah,
the
exactly. Elf. Yeah. And I mean, you can have like all sorts of funny stuff, like Gollum calling like that, like Radbag ugly, and Radbag is like, what? Like, you know? Like,
okay, I really need to play this game to figure out what the whole deal with this Radbag guy is.
You know what? It's not that he's a particularly great character,
yeah.
But my god, when you place him in front of Talion, it's like, like literally it feels like like the gods of literature have created this character and it's fucking amazing.
Yeah, basically, yeah, like any character you place in front of Talion becomes better just by, like, comparison. Like,
Wait. Yeah. Okay, I have a question for you guys. Is Talion better or is Connor better from Assassin's Creed 3?
Oh God, that's hard. Actually, I was going to say Talion better, but now I got
it. Okay, this is genuinely tough. Yeah.
Connor is a bit better, but not by much.
I mean, for Connor, at least, I could just hate the whole game. I didn't have to like the game and like dislike Connor. I just like, oh yeah, this whole game is crap.
And Assassin's Creed 3 wasn't bad because of Connor. It was bad because the game was bad.
Yeah.
Like, you know, the writers really fucked up that plot.
Yeah. I mean, and then this, like, it's a game you feel like where the protagonist is holding back the game. Not just holding back, actively dragging it back.
Yeah,
like, I mean, like, I don't get that. Like, why did you get, like, the LOTR license if you had to just, like, completely phone it in, you know, the lore aspect? Like, I don't get that. Like,
yeah.
I mean, game is pretty great. Like,
game is enjoyable.
Man, actually, you know what? Now I really can't decide. I think Talion might be a bit better than fucking Connor because.
I think that is a tough question.
At least for me, like, it was like, yeah, well, Connor is bad, but like I hate more like the game more than Connor. Here, like, I love the game, but I hate Talion.
Just asking about Talion and Connor. I don't care about the games, you know.
that is a hard question.
It's context, right? So. Yeah, like, I still hate Talion because he makes a thing I like worse instead of like Connor just like makes like a thing more bad, slightly bad actually, not even that much. So yeah.
Like Connor makes a mediocre game kind of like more meh. Basically.
Yeah. Hmm. And like at least with Connor, I feel like those guys tried to do something interesting, you know, like Native American heritage, struggling between, like, all that stuff. So, like, on paper...
Like, they use that as token shit.
I'm giving them the best benefit of the doubt here. Like, at least they tried. Like, you know, at least, like, they tried. So at least there is that. With Talion, there is no trying. Like, there's, like, yeah. So, I would like to know, like, if the person who came up with Talion got paid. Like, seriously. Like, if they, because, yeah, like, what? Though I do think in this case, like, it was probably, like, the executives. They were like, we need a relatable character. Maybe Talion is the person who, like, executives relate to. I don't know.
I don't think it's that. I honestly think that, you know, I think that this was the story they came up with, and this is what they wanted to make, because that, and like, I guess it is the era of the, like, we're still in that era of the bearded, gnarly protagonist with a tragic past who, you know,
like, revenge solves everything.
Very, very, I don't have a problem with, like, you know what? I don't have a problem with someone like Talion being the hero. I have a problem with this story being so goddamn lazy. It's so lazy.
Yeah, like, I mean, if you're gonna have a, like, completely flavorless character like Talion, like, call him out on his stuff. Like, when he starts branding orcs and, like, massacring them by the...
That. Fine, you want to do a standard revenge drama, but, you know, like, the reason revenge dramas work is that you care about the characters who are taking revenge.
Yeah.
Give a shit about their motivations.
Yeah.
Exactly. That's what made Assassin's Creed 2 to be such a good game. I mean, in terms of this whole revenge thing that we're
discussing.
Because
you spend 2 hours getting to know his family, right?
Yeah. Yeah.
And then they die in a really brutal way in front of you.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And I mean, I love Assassin's Creed 2 had a lot of problems, but you guys remember that scene where, like, you chase your brother and then, like, both of you are sitting in the, like, in front of a roof and, like, the sweetest Italian music is playing.
Mm.
And, like, I felt like, yeah, like, this is family. So that was very well done. Like,
the initial missions in that game where you're just a young hooligan who gets into trouble and,
yeah,
like, it is very, very, it's very, very Bollywood movie.
But yeah.
At the same time, it does the job that all those Bollywood movies do, like the good ones do well.
Yeah.
Make the hero relatable. And they don't bother to do that legwork here. They don't bother, like, if they had done just, if the first 2 hours is basically Talion just as a ranger going out and doing missions and you get to know his family, and then orcs invade and, like, everybody dies. It's just so much more effective. At that point, you understand why he wants to go out and murder everyone. But now it's just like you get 2 minutes, like Arvind said, 30 seconds of family, and then all of a sudden he's like murder mode activated.
It's a bit I think it's a game that like is this little bit short of becoming one of the all-time best games. Like, So I mean, it's a great game, like, definitely. But yeah, it's a little bit short of greatness. Hopefully they can, like, fix that in the future, like, and stuff like that.
Oh, great.
So, what was the other game we were talking about? Far Cry 3 Blood Dragon.
Blood Dragon.
So, Rashi, you played this game. What do you think about
it? I'm still playing the game. Again, I was doing more of the side quests than the main missions. I mean, there's just 7 main missions, so I don't want to rush it. I think it's a surprisingly excellent game. There's so much of randomness going on in the game that, I don't know, I just stopped bothering about whether stuff makes sense, and I just went ahead with whatever they're throwing at me, and it's an amazing game. I'm totally enjoying it. After the seriousness of Shadow of Mordor, maybe it's a huge break or something. I don't know, but I'm really surprised at just how fun that game is.
For me at least, like, I played this before Shadow of Mordor, like, way back. So for me, like, I loved the the opening was terrible, and, like, for me, like, it lost the, like, once the whole, you know, like, it's like, you know, yari log kya kar rahe hain, ki kuch bhi karte hain, jaisa wala feeling hoti hai na. Like, you're like, oh my god, anything is happening. So you're just, like, on the ride to, like, see what crazy stuff they come up with next.
Yeah.
like once that novelty wore off, there wasn't anything like much left for me. So I never finished it. But yeah, like I love the like aesthetic at least. Like
yeah. I mean, I don't know. I enjoyed. It was fun, you know. At times, especially you know what I did was the first thing I did was liberating all the garrisons. So it was fun, you know, disabling the mega shields and then luring the blood dragons in and just, you know, going at hiding on top of the buildings and just, you know, watch the show. So it was actually fun getting introduced with the blood dragons, and they're quite scary. Even though I'm pretty powerful now, I'm level 27, I think, and I run like mad if there's a blood dragon around. I guess I'm still enjoying the randomness that the game has. It's completely silly.
Vivek, you've played it?
No, I played Far Cry 3. I've beaten Far Cry 3, and I have Blood Dragon, but I've not installed it. I don't have any plans to play it, because after finishing Far Cry 3, I think I'm done with Far Cry in general.
Yeah, like yeah, I guess that's one thing. Yeah, it has. It's very much a reskin of the same exact like structure of game.
Yeah, and Far Cry 4 doesn't look like it's going to be tremendously different. It doesn't look like they're going to try and do what Far Cry 2 did. So I'm going to stay away from that franchise. And
yeah, Far Cry 4 looks to be like same structure but new toys is the best way to put it. I think. Like,
I think it's going to be closer to Blood Dragon because you know the elephants are going to be pretty powerful. That's what I feel. So I mean, obviously they won't shoot lasers from their eyes, but I think they'll be like this powerful blood dragon kind of thing, and you know, you just basically run if an elephant comes after you. So that's what I feel. But I don't know. I'm enjoying the. I enjoyed it more than Far Cry 3. I enjoyed Far Cry 3 as well. I liked it. I don't know.
It's a pretty good game. Yeah, but just that like, I guess it's just like. Like the tolerance level is different, I guess.
Maybe.
So, yeah, I guess that was a short conversation. And even like Tejas, you were playing this other game, right? What was it?
Dungeons of the Endless.
Yeah, that one. Yeah, tell us about it.
Well, I've just started it. I bought it like not more than a few hours ago. So, it's by the same guys who made Endless Space and then Endless Legend, and this is the third part of their Endless series. So, they have apparently they all have like very similar little aspects and lie on the same continuum in some weird way. But the game is this mash of roguelike and tower defense, and like, just first impressions, I'm loving the game so far. It's very clever. The way it works is you're part of, like, narrative-wise, you're part of this penitentiary ship that's going from one system to the other when it crashes and, you know, crashes on some planet. So you get to choose which two heroes survive. And I'm guessing later on I'll also get to choose what sort of escape pod it was, with different escape pods having different bonuses. And you take these heroes and you basically explore outside of your crash site one room at a time because you're underground or something. And so it's like a roguelike in the sense that you are basically going from one, you know, like uncovering this fog of war around you, while trying to find the exit to the next stage. But where they've gotten really clever is that when you unlock a room, you have you collect dust, which is their power resource, and so you can then choose to power a room. And each room has these little nodes on which you can then build like these little turrets of different types. And you know, so these heroes move around, they attack monsters. Sometimes monsters will start moving along these rooms to go towards your main base, and you know the turrets obviously help out. And when you finally find an exit is actually when it gets really fun. a whole bunch of waves start coming in towards the where you are. And you have to take the energy crystal in your, you know, center location out to wherever the elevator is to actually end that level and get to the next part. And so, yeah, I've only had one playthrough so far where I only got to level 2 of 12. So I'll be playing it again and probably giving more detailed thoughts, when I've actually gone through all the systems and kind of figured it out.
Okay, this is an early access now, right?
It's out. It's not early access. It's full release.
It's not early access?
It was no, early access, but I think it's released now.
Yeah,
yeah.
It just came out. You know, it came out of early access.
Still calling it early access. Weird.
Yeah, Steam does that sometimes. Yeah.
Yeah, they do that sometimes. It takes a while for them to update. This was something over which some, I think a Steam developer threatened Gabe Newell for no good reason, I think. A game that was full release showed up as early access, then he threatened Gabe Newell, then...
Oh yeah, that guy.
That guy is now, like, I think completely done.
He quit.
Yeah, that's a sad story that had nothing to do with what we were talking about.
Yeah.
I do feel sorry for that dude, though. Like, I mean, I can understand why he lost his shit. I'm not saying he should have, or even if he did, he shouldn't have, you know, gone that route. But I can't understand why he got so pissed off.
Yeah, it's weird. Why would you, like, I mean, I don't know. All right, guys, that's it for this week. Dave's signing off. With me are Arvind.
Bye.
Tejas.
Hello, and goodbye.
And Rashi.
See you later.
See you guys next week. Bye.